name is Deborah of B&B, and I am a member of the
Okay.
Thank you very much for coming this evening. My name is Deborah K.M.B. and I'm a member of the Scottish Socialist Party in Edinburgh. And this evening I'm supposed to chair this meeting about Muhammad Ali. I think some of us, certainly recently we have seen on TV his passing, and I've learned a lot about the man, even though at the time he came into the Congo, I was just born that year, so I didn't know much about him. This evening we have this opportunity for Jonathon. As you know, all Jonathon, you know him better than me. He's going to talk to us about his life. Before we start, I want to share this quote from Dr. Martin Luther King. He says once, "Nothing in all the world is more dangerous than sincere ignorance and conscienceless stupidity. If every day we put ourselves to learn about others and things that happen around the world, it makes us a better person. And the stupidity that we see around us, just in a minute, in a second, we realize how bad it is and how dangerous it is in our society." So, Jonathon, this is your time. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Can people hear me without the microphone? Okay, well, I'm not going to talk too much, but I want to probably just start by mapping out a few framework issues. I'm going to talk, obviously, about Muhammad Ali, obviously about his sporting achievements, about his political influences, about his impact on both the sporting world and on the society around him. But I want to, given what's going on, try and extrapolate from that some wider contextual issues that I think are useful to discuss. He's one of these people, very much like Nelson Mandela, who, when he dies, there's a whole range of people who hated him when he was alive, but very much like him when he's dead. And that often is the mark of people who are willing to rebel, people who are revolutionary in their outlook, and people who challenge the status quo. Interestingly enough, Donald Trump was one of these people who praised Muhammad Ali, said there'll never be one like him again. Of course, he's famously a Muslim, and would he be banned from living in the United States is an open question if Donald Trump became the president. And just on that, I will end towards the end, touch on where we are now with civil rights, and I will focus those comments on America in particular. So Muhammad Ali, of course, when you think about great people who excelled in their area of expertise, you often wonder how they got there, how it all happened. And with Muhammad Ali, he was born in Kentucky in 1942. He was born at a real moment where, you know, he knew exactly what it meant to be oppressed. He knew exactly what it meant to be abused racially, and so on and so forth. This is, of course, a time which just comes before the onset of the mass civil rights movement. And Muhammad Ali, I do mention him later. Muhammad Ali first actually got involved in thinking about how he might become a boxer when his bike got stolen. It was a sort of curious twist of fate that his bike got stolen, and he wanted to run after the individual who stole the bike, and he encountered a police officer who then became his trainer, who said, "Well, if you're going to challenge someone, then you better learn how to fight." And that's actually how he started to get involved in the whole business of boxing and training and that sort of thing. Of course, his name at the time, Cassius Clay, and I'll talk about why and how he changed his name later on. But, you know, he was someone who lived through absolutely momentous times, as we are living right now. But he lives in a time, and he grows up in a time and becomes famous and well known for boxing, in a time where you have a whole social, political upheaval, revolution going on in the United States. There's a very famous interview carried out by William Buckley, who many of you will know. He was, of course, someone who was a sort of standard bearer for social conservatism and for the right wing in American society. He looked upon what was happening during the 1960s with a great deal of horror. He didn't want to see liberation when it came to LGBT rights. He didn't want to see the equalisation when it came to race, or when it came to income and all these types of things. He was very much someone of the 1940s and 1950s. And one of his famous sort of jousts that he has is with Gore Vidal, and some of you may have already seen this, but this debate between him and Vidal really came to sort of crystallise the issues of the day. And there was a real, almost bad-tempered, very bad-tempered argument raging throughout American society about the direction which it would take. And so William Buckley does an interview with Muhammad Ali, and it's one of the most fascinating bits of television that you could watch. I mean, I would urge you to have a look at it. It's all online. It's interesting because what happens in the interview is that William Buckley says, "Why do you call the white man a devil?" This is the point where Muhammad Ali is being politicised and so on. And he gives this response where he talks about slavery, he talks about the oppression of the present day, he talks about the way in which black people are being treated by white establishment in America. And it's interesting that William Buckley actually then admits after the interview that he was quite right, in a sense. He couldn't come back. I mean, remember, this is a real intellectual of the day, William Buckley. He couldn't come back to this boxer born in Kentucky. You know, he couldn't come back to the argument that really what we were seeing in America was this mass sort of oppression going on, but at the same time connected with it, a rebellion against it, which expresses itself in a myriad of ways throughout the 1960s. I will talk about his sporting achievements now before I talk about some of these other interactions throughout the 1960s, in particular the Vietnam War. I mean, if you look at his achievements, you look at the impact that he's made in this particular sport, you have to say that very, very unique, just the impact that he makes. He is the greatest boxer that's ever lived. That's fairly undisputed. But the way in which he grows as a boxer is the thing that's fascinating, because it's almost as if as he grows as a boxer, he's also growing as a political commentator, as an activist, as someone who wants to make an impact in the world more generally. And he won, of course, the Olympic medal for boxing, in which he was lauded as a great American sports person. But then political events begin to take over. The Vietnam War, which he refuses to fight in. And of course there's the famous quote which he says about the Vietnam War, which I will read because I think it's powerful and I think it speaks to the time and also speaks to the present day. And he says, "My conscience won't let me go shoot my brother or some darker people or some poor hungry people in the mud for big powerful America and shoot them for what? They never called me nigger, they never lynched me, they didn't put no dogs on me, they didn't rob me of my nationality, rape or kill my mother and father. How can I shoot these poor people? Just take me to jail." And of course he was convicted. And at this point he's not allowed to box anymore. And what I'm trying to do here is to show that it's impossible, in a sense, to dislocate his sporting life, his sporting success, with his political convictions. And I think often there is an attempt to de-link these issues in liberal sections of the media and in right-wing sections of the media. They're very happy that he's a good boxer. They're very happy that he excels in his sport. But not so happy that he leads this charge against the Vietnam War, that he doesn't sign up, that he doesn't go to fight. And they're even less happy for his reasons. See, it wasn't just because he makes this turn to Islam and renames himself, Muhammad Ali. By the way, I should say that the purpose of renaming yourself is that you don't have a name associated with a previous slave owner. And it was a rebirth that he took under when he makes his turn to Islam, the Nation of Islam. But it wasn't even that they could accept, well, okay, he has some religious conviction. You look at the quote I've just read out, it cuts into the very heart of imperialism, of racism, of the racist history of the United States, but it also, quite clearly in my head, cuts into the question of class. Because what he's essentially saying is, I have far more in common, much, much more in common, with the Vietnamese who are being bombed than I do with the American establishment. And actually that sense of class solidarity is something that came to speak for the movement as a whole, the anti-Vietnam War movement. There was a real sense amongst soldiers as well, the United States GIs, that they had far more in common with those they were fighting against than they did with those who were given the orders to fight in the first place. He was stripped of his passport. He was fined £10,000, a lot of money at the time. Stripped of his rights. Denied a boxing license on every single state. I mean, this is history which is often forgotten when you read about the life and times of Muhammad Ali. But stripped of his passport, he was prevented from fighting between March 1967 and October 1970. About these years, though, for this athlete, for this supreme talent, is that these were the years in which he would have been at his absolute best. And there's an irony in that, I think, that as he makes this statement of opposition to what the United States is doing, then it seems that they take away from him the thing which he's best at, the thing that he is most popular for. Remember that he was widely seen in American society as a real hero for winning the Olympic medal for boxing. And in a sense, it's no surprise that the NSA were tapping his phone in the years after this, the National Security Agency. And there was a real sense, I think, in which powerful figures, popular figures, who were rebelling against the establishment on a whole number of levels, they needed to silence them. And again, I think we can look today and see, I mean, we might, if I dare, draw the comparison to someone even like Jeremy Corbyn. They can't accept discourse taking its place in the mainstream of political discussion if it doesn't fit into the parameters agreed by the establishment. And that's something I think that runs with Muhammad Ali throughout this thing. I do want to just mention here, just quickly, about the 1960s. I mentioned Tariq Ali earlier on, in part because I wanted to just bring in some reflections about everything else that was going on at the time, while he's being stripped of these rights and so on. And of course, 1968, a year in which we see, obviously, the great rebellions in France, taken by students and others. But the 1960s, when you think about it, really is a decade in which things change. You think about the popularity of the Beatles. Now, that might sound slightly out of place in a speech like this, but actually it reflected a huge shift going on in culture. Martin Luther King gave his most famous speech, the I Have a Dream speech, in front of a million people. We had the Stonewall riots. The first time in human history that there were real big protests and resistance over the question of LGBT rights. Of course, we landed on the moon. This is a decade I think is important because it seems to me that something happens, and I'm slightly going off on a tangent here, but something happens throughout that decade which I think precipitates a fork in the road for left-wing and right-wing values going forward in the 70s, 80s, and where we are now. And it seems to me that what happened was that the left essentially won most of the arguments when it came to social arrangements. When it came to the question of race, when it came to the question of gay rights, when it came to the question of this sense of there being a social equality, then I think the left and the progressive movements of the time shaped the decades to come. David Cameron, if you look at it, and if you look at, you know, John Major, even if you look in some instances before that at the right wing in both British and American societies, then there's a kind of acceptance that on these issues we're going to give ground because there's been such an upsurge from below that it couldn't be resisted. But on the economic issues, then they were to take their own ideology forward and entrench it in neoliberalism, deregulation, privatisation, and so on and so forth. And in a sense, I think what we're seeing today is that there's a new context, there's a new battle of ideas that's taking place. Because what's happening now is more and more people are beginning to question the economy. There's a real sense in which people understand that it doesn't work for everyone, that it leads inextricably to a growing gap between the wealthy in society and the poorest in society. And at the same time, we are seeing a battle rage over the social questions that we face as a society. So if you look at America just now, you have this whole sense in which there's a new civil rights movement. But isn't it depressing that there must be another new civil rights movement in America? Black Lives Matter, of course, protesting against the likes of Donald Trump. Donald Trump representing this kind of new brand of social conservatism. We might draw some comparisons with the recent vote that we've had over the question of the European Union. Peter Hitchens, not someone who I'd often quote, but I think he's interesting, and I think he's an interesting observer of what happens in the world, and what happens in particular in Britain, says that this is a sort of rebellion of social conservatism that we see take place. I'm not sure about that. But more about that later. But I'm just sort of pointing out here that his life takes place in this context, and so does his death. And the death of Muhammad Ali, the way people orientate on it, tells you quite a lot about their politics. Muhammad Ali also devoted a lot of time towards, as well as politics, philanthropy. He was someone who began to express, particularly to black youth, the possibility of building a life, of building dignity, of building respect. He talked about people giving him awards and so on and so forth. And he said that he didn't want a museum built in his name, just full of all his memorabilia, just full of all his medals and so on and so forth. He wanted something to be built that suggested or implored other black people in the direction of winning. Now, in his case, he was talking about boxing, but he wasn't just talking about boxing, he was talking about winning respect, about winning arguments, about being dignified, about not letting people put you down. That, I think, is what typifies Muhammad Ali, even if you go right back to where we started, where he gets his bike stolen and he wants to challenge the person who steals his bike. Donald Trump, I have mentioned, and I did say that I would come back to him. And Muhammad Ali did have some words for Donald Trump in reaction to his comments about banning Muslims entering the United States. He says, this is important, he says, we as Muslims have to stand up to those who use Islam to advance their own personal agenda. They have alienated many from learning about Islam. True Muslims know or should know that it goes against our religion to try and force Islam on anyone. If you dissect that, there are some really important insights. And bear in mind, he's saying this at a time when his health is really deteriorating, of course. He suffers from Alzheimer's section of his life. But if you dissect what he says, essentially that he's drawing what may seem obvious, but which I think is fairly profound, is this sense that actually Islam, the demonization of Islam, more to the point, is being used to the benefit of objectives sought by sections of the ruling class. And of course, he's talking here about Trump, and he says about people benefiting personally, but quite easily could be talking about the Bush administration, and the Blair administration, who both, in tandem with, I would argue, a weaponised media campaign, demonised large sections of the Muslim population in order to justify a war against terror. It's quite depressing in a way. I'm not going to end on a depressing note, but it is quite depressing in a way that he has this life, that he achieves so much, and this, I think, gets to the essence of what it means to be oppressed. What it means to be oppressed is, regardless of what you achieve, regardless of how you achieve it, the skill, the ability, the victories that you have, there's always something that's going and running in parallel with that. And that's that you're constantly undermined in some way or other by an establishment who can't accept, who really can't accept, that there's the possibility of genuine equality. Let's talk about Obama. I'm just coming to some concluding points, because the title is about the struggle for justice today as well. Now, Obama, when you think about it, also represents this kind of contradiction. It also represents what it means to live in a society in which oppression is a real and living thing. You have a black president, but at the same time as having a black president, you also have a major spike in racist incidents, in police brutality, in police killings. You also have, at the same time as a black president, this new civil rights movement arise, the need for it, again, which I mentioned earlier. This, to me, says that liberal anti-racism or liberal approaches to oppression in general don't work. Because the liberal will say, well, we have equality now. We have a black president. It shows that in America you can do anything. Okay, we've had this whole history of slavery and so on and so forth, but at the end of the day,